So the specific talk is university relations with non-human animals, the governance of animals and students as you at UBC as a political problem. We have two amazing panelists with us today. The first is Laura Janara, who is an associate professor in political science. She's a political philosopher who studies the historical formation of identity categories, including human relations with non-humans against the backdrop of capitalism, colonialism, and democracy. A couple of years ago, she and a group of faculty students organized a series of scholarly talks at UBC's Green College on the university's relationship with non-human animals. And then we have Elizabeth Ormandy. She completed her undergrad honors degree in neuroscience and a master's degree in applied animal behavior and welfare at the University of Edinburgh. And she's currently a postdoctoral research fellow at UBC in animal welfare. So, without further ado.
Like other groups in our history, necessary, and they've been determined to be ethical. And apparently, this properly authorized and exhaustive public investigation of ethics that has supposedly happened has rationally produced the current university practices. The regime discourse also suggests that the CCAC oversight system ensures that the subjections that are enacted daily at universities meet these ethical measures, namely that each act of subjection is necessary and humane, that each one reflects an imperative to reduce and replace and refine the use of animals. In other words, the language indicates that prevailing university practice has moorings in the past and moorings in the present that render it politically legitimate. Only none of this is true. None of this is true. In reality, this discourse captures neither the true origins, nor the actual powers, nor the practical achievements of CCAC oversight and the related university practices. Instead, the CCAC regime is the effect of the increasingly institutionalized scientific research community and its effort, in conjunction with the Canadian state, which funds much of its research, to frame and manage an ethically and politically contestable practice, a practice that's been made possible by Canada's enclosure of politically and legally unprotected lives. In turn, the CCAC legitimates and thus helps reproduce this practice in a stable form, so it just keeps going in history. Furthermore, the points in the oversight system at which the necessity these checks are actually very unreliable. The third big argument that I'm presenting is that the CCAC system is said to serve the welfare, this is the language of the regime, the CCAC system is said to serve the welfare of animals through care. So it's about welfare and care. What I want to suggest is that the CCAC system codifies practices of subjection that enact a wide range of types of harms to non-human animals. It habituates humans in these practices of harm. The CCAC governance system normalizes, in other words, a particular way of being human. It normalizes a particular way of being human. The CCAC system defines these human practices through rationalized administrative complexes of official reporting. It's a lot of reporting and a lot of statistics and files. This reporting trades in the abstract and language of experimental models, animals are experimental models, and endpoints, killing is an endpoint. This institutional disciplining of human thinking and action depoliticizes university practice. It shelters university practice from publicity and from political and ethical interrogation. Okay, so I want to talk about Canada. The modern states that we have in the Western world today, they have solidified human domination of animals in a manner that we've never seen before in history. So I want to talk about Canada in this context. Canada was constituted by Europeans supplanting indigenous social and political loans and orders with Britain's common law tradition. So we're on unceded Musqueam land, but we are following Britain's common law tradition, and that common law tradition situates non-humans as human property. So what is law? Well, the law is not given by nature. It's something that we create in history, and it's something that we challenge in history. With respect to how Canada's law divides persons from animals, we can think about the impact of this, and here I'm quoting Kerry Wolfe, who's a scholar. He says, we are all always already animals before the law. Those are the categories that we have in Canada, persons and animals. We are all always already potential animals before the law. The distinction human-animal, as the history of slavery, colonialism, and imperialism well shows, it's a discursive resource, not a zoological designation. So we can call people animals, and that will affect their political standing in the colony, because we have this category of animals that is opposed to persons. And those who fall outside the frame because they are marked by differences of race or species or gender or religion or nationality are always threatened with being non-criminal put to death. In the USA today, for instance, chickens, so this is chickens are excluded from the Humane Methods of Livestock Slaughter Act. They're not even legally qualified as livestock in the U.S., thanks to the law. Mice, rats, and birds are excluded from the Animal Welfare Act. They're not even qualified as animals in the U.S. Meanwhile, this act defines person as, listen to how broad this is, any individual, partnership, firm, joint stock, company, corporation, association, trust, estate, or other legal entity. This is the arbitrariness and power legislation, the nature of the law. So Canada, what is Canada? Canada's Constitution Act of 1867, it organizes this thing that we call Canada. This act is silent on animals and silent on human and non-human relations. This silence has an effect. It embeds non-human animals in Canada as figures and as material that is susceptible to Canada's federal-provincial division of powers. So we have the federal government on one hand. The federal government may act towards non-humans in Canada in ways that accord with its prescribed jurisdiction. Today, the federal government is using its prescribed jurisdiction towards animals in certain ways. It's using these powers to frame non-human animals as material of fisheries, agriculture, trade and commerce, and as human property. The federal government, of course, also holds jurisdiction in Canada over citizenship. Through history, Canada's federal government has variously denied and granted citizenship status to different groups. Echoing British common law, it presently deprives non-humans of citizenship. On the other hand, we have provinces. Provinces may also act through their prescribed jurisdictions, according to the Constitution Act. Today, they're exercising their powers by situating non-human animals as human property and as material to use in educational facilities, amongst other things. So in Spain, you know, great apes, like humans, have a right to life. In Canada, they do not. In New Zealand, chimpanzees and other primates have legal standing that protects them from being subjects of experimentation. In Canada, they do not. In Canada, the ways that federal and provincial governments are using their constitutional powers, in fact, permits universities to widely subject non-human animals. Further, the federal government is actively enabling university relations with animals in two main ways. First of all, in 1892, Canada's Criminal Code, 1892, I'll just reiterate that date. 1892, Canada's Criminal Code codified animals as human property, addressing cruelty against them in the context of them being human property. 100 years later, in 1998, the federal Liberal government introduced a bill to change the Criminal Code so that cruelty to animals is not a property crime, with humans being the owners of that property, but rather animals themselves would be protected as subjects from cruelty, subjects who themselves can feel pain. This bill did not reach royal assent. So Canada's way of conceptualizing cruelty to animals remains basically unchanged since 1892. So in the Criminal Code, animals are categorized as human property, and the Criminal Code says, everyone commits an offense who willfully causes or any owner willfully permits to be caused unnecessary pain, suffering, or injury to an animal or a bird. And by the way, that final phrase, animal or bird, reminds us of the arbitrary nature of the law. Birds are set outside of the category of animal there. So the Criminal Code protects animals as property from unnecessary pain, suffering, or injury. This law does not challenge, but rather works within standing social norms in Canada. So standing social norms will actually give us information about what people think to be unnecessary suffering and pain. Given that scientific research and teaching communities have normalized the causing of pain, suffering, and injury, that is because these practices are now calcified as socially normal, teaching and research activities are very unlikely to be considered legally cruel. They're just accepted as normal. So that's the first main way that the federal government is shaping university relations with animals, by way of the Criminal Code. The second main way is by way of what is called the federal spending power. This is a very powerful thing. The government spends money, it disperses money that enables society to do things. So the government has agencies that fund, oops, thank you. happens at universities. Research involving humans, so we do some research that involves humans, and that research is governed by a federal policy that says that research must be sensitive to the inherent worth of all, and it must show respect for persons, concern for welfare, and justice. So that's for research covering humans. Research that involves non-humans is separated out and governed differently. It is instead subject to CCAC policies and guidelines. The CCAC does not cite the inherent worth of all as its guiding concern, nor does it cite issues of respect and justice. Rather, the CCAC mission is to assume the subjection of animals in research, testing, and teaching, and to enhance their welfare in that context, not absolutely, it does not enhance their welfare absolutely as beings with standing, but rather in this context in which they already face institutionalized subjection. And let me add, you know, today we're speaking about the university, we're members of the university, we're speaking of the university, but in Canada, outside of universities, there are labs that breed and use and kill animals that don't seek funding from the federal government. These labs are not required to heed CCAC guidelines. So animals who find themselves in these hands, in these other labs, they live, they suffer, and die in some of the darkest shadows of the Canadian political community. And so we see the true political and legal vulnerability of animals in Canada in this context. And the CCAC regime is a superficial layer over this baseline reality. Okay, I'm going to talk now about how the CCAC came to be created. Through the last century, in the context of Canada's constitutional framework, scientific disciplines have developed norms that started to self-reproduce over time. You know, norms are self-reinforcing, self-reproducing over time. And science, of course, is not free of norms. It is a social practice by humans that works off its own culture that then reproduces itself. And one thing that science has done in the 20th century is normalize non-human animals as experimental models, making this the culture. In Canada, backed by the state, the scientific research communities then organized modes of self-regulation of their subjection of animals, And they worked up an accompanying discourse of ethical and humane treatment and care of these politically unqualified figures. In 1963, Canada's National Research Council requested a study of, quote, the situation with regard to the humane use and care of experimental animals, end quote. So in this moment, experimental animals was codified, was established as a Canadian category of being. We now had this as a category of being in the Canadian political community. The charged committee recommended that there be formed a voluntary program in which scientists would provide each other with peer review, implementing the guiding principles of an independent advisory body. And in 1968, this advisory body, the CCAC, was then formed to make these guidelines and policies so that the scientists could then provide peer review for each other in light of these guidelines and policies. So here's what I really want to say about all of this. In sum, Canada's university animal relations are not the effect of some past public debate. Those making the decisions never suspended the presumption of animals as open to domination. Canada's university animal relations today are not the effect of robust public deliberation in which all affected parties have been represented. Neither the question of what constitutes ethical relations between human scholars and animals, nor even what the mandate of the oversight system, what it should be, none of this has been publicly taken up in Canada. Not when European Canadians submerged the ethics of Indigenous nations, not by representatives of all who were folded into the sovereign power of the Canadian polity, not by politically qualified male citizens prior to females getting the vote in Canada, not by Canada's contemporary diverse publics, nor even by an expert public of trained ethicists. CCAC bylaws read, I think I have to switch slides. Okay, CCAC bylaws read, the purpose of the CCAC is to act in the interests of the people of Canada. actually very highly diverse. Moreover, serving them is often not remotely necessary. They're just our interests that we would like to have served. Yet the CCAC also invokes the premise of necessity. This is the language of necessity. And this word is, in fact, intensively used in discourse about animal experimentation in general. You know, that's what's said, that it's necessary. It's sad, but it's necessary. Now, the CCAC mandate does not claim that research subjection of animals is necessary or essential to humanity as a species, and it doesn't make this claim because it can't make this claim. So how does the CCAC justify animal subjection? What is the CCAC's standing criterion for animal subjection in science? Well, its standing criterion is whether animal subjection is needed for proposed programs of research, teaching, and product testing. Do these proposed programs of research testing and teaching, as they've been conceived by scientists in our currently existing scientific communities in the way that they think and the cultures that they're governed by, are these programs that have been proposed, do they require the use of animals? Of course, these programs are constructed and desired by some humans and fueled by some very often unnamed human interests in the context of what we call a prevailing animal use ideology. Competing human interests are entirely conceivable. And why should only human interests rule the planet? Furthermore, the CCAC's mandate might have been something different than what it is. It might have been to ensure that the subjection of animals meets not scientists' view of scientific merit, but rather that the subjection of animals has to hold significant social merit. The CCAC mandate might be to ensure that any subjection of non-humans is necessary to the collective interests of life in a sustainable biosphere. Or it could be to represent animals, to serve justice for all affected parties in a sustainable biosphere. We also were told that standard university practice is legitimate because it does, or it convincingly may, provide benefits to humans that outweigh the costs to the animals. That the benefits to humans outweigh the cost to the animals. You know, first of all, let me just say, well, so what if they do? There's still costs that need to be ethically accounted for. So even the general formulation of that claim doesn't matter. But let's also ask whether the benefits to humans do outweigh the cost to the animals. In fact, no comprehensive analysis of costs and benefits has ever happened in Canada, nor does it happen as part of the oversight system. The sides of the ledger were never brought together to bear upon each other, nor are they in an ongoing way brought to bear upon each other to justify to demonstrate this justifying claim. So in sum, the CCAC regime and the standing modes of pursuing disciplinary knowledges at Canadian universities require, it seems to me, the closing off of political questions, the closing off of ethical questions, to facilitate particular kinds of knowledge seeking. Other fundamental problems of knowledge have been forsaken. And that's what I'm trying to do in my research, to reopen those questions or to open those questions up, those political and ethical questions, so that the university actually sees that it's obligated to take up those forms of knowledge as well. So I'm going to talk a little bit now about the actual structure of the CCAC, how it actually functions in relation to the university. The CCAC justifies itself as accountable to the general public. Accountable to the general public. Now it was, as I've said, founded by a narrow, partisan, biased public, in fact, but the CCAC suggests that it now operates since that founding on the basis of broader public authority from the people of Canada. This claim, you know, this doesn't take into account the interests of animals, but it is pointing to the people of Canada as the authorizing body of the CCAC. But even this claim is unsustainable. Nowhere does the broader Canadian public grant authority to the CCAC regime. The CCAC's governing body is, so it has a governing body, it's a council of representatives from 22 national organizations. And, you know, a lot can be said about this, and Elizabeth knows a great deal about this, so perhaps some of you will have questions about this, but suffice it to say for now that these member organizations mostly share an obvious political commitment to what we might call an animal use ideology. The breadth of Canada's diverse publics are not at the table in this discussion at all, and representation of non-humans is not even named as a goal by the CCAC Council. Meanwhile, the CCAC has an offshoot in each university, a committee in each university that's called the Animal Care Committee. So UBC has an Animal Care Committee. Does the broader public get a voice here at the level of the local ACC, the local Animal Care Committee? Well, an ACC is supposed to include scientists and or teachers with experience in animal use. It's supposed to include an experienced veterinarian, a technical staff representative, and one student. It should also include one university member who does not use animals, and it should include one or more community representatives. Well, as a political philosopher, I have to say that random individual university members and community members do not a robust Canadian public make. It is not specified even who these discrete individuals represent or how they can be assured to represent. I'm sure they do their best on these committees, but the committee structure is fundamentally problematic. The claims about what the committee is fundamentally So in sum, there's no authorization of the CCAC by identifiable and actually diverse Canadian publics. But because of the CCAC regime, universities can say, we comply with the rules. We're good. We comply. There's no problem. And universities may then, as UBC has done, may then dismiss political critique that's coming from actual Canadian publics. They may dismiss it as pathological, as irrational, and even as dangerous, as they have done. So how are proposed science projects approved in Canada? Well, a project is approved first, singularly, for its scientific merit. That's the measuring stick. That's how things get approved first and foremost in the world of science. Does it have scientific merit, scientific value? So the funding review asks whether proposed research fits the standing cultures of the university's scientific disciplines. This is how things get reproduced socially. This assessment requires no detailed explanation of the planned use of animals. It's only after a funding body legitimates planned research by funding it, only after the research is thus assured to proceed in some form, that the proposed use of animals is even considered. So the ethics of animal use is considered second. This assessment is managed by the local arm of the CCAC that is housed at the university, that is the ACC, the Animal Care Committee. So UBC has an ACC, as I said. The ACC is required to accept the prior funding decision that says the funded project has scientific merit. So that's already a given once a project comes home to the university. The ACC then works around the edges of this approval to consider animal use. So I've already said who's on an ACC. An ACC is not a body of trained ethicists. It's not a body of diverse citizens. The ACC merely assesses submitted protocols according to CCAC guidelines and policies. So it's all happening within the frame of the animal use ideology. And the ACC members do this on the basis of what? What do they hear from research and teachers about the proposed use of animals? They receive a 500-word description of the project. That's the basis on which they made their evaluations. Now, some UBC scholars from our animal welfare program have recently done a study of the function, of the internal function of ACCs, of these animal care committees at universities. And this study shows that animal care committee composition is biased in favor of institutional and research interests, and it's biased against the interests of animals and the community. This study shows that committee dynamics prevent full participation of all members. It's not hard to imagine. And the study shows that some members pursue agendas that diverge from the ACC mandate, that excessive volume of committee responsibilities and inadequate participation obstruct adequate review of research. And the study shows that low ACC membership turnover calcifies thinking on the ACC. So on the basis of what terms does the ACC do its work? You know, how does it organize its thinking? Well, the CCAC has given categories through which we're to do this thinking. The CCAC has legitimated five categories of harm in Canada within which researchers and teachers may work. Category A involves experiments on most invertebrates or live isolates. Category B is experiments which cause little or no discomfort or stress. Category C is experiments which cause minor stress or pain of short duration. Category D is experiments which cause moderate to severe distress or discomfort. And category E is procedures which cause severe pain near, at, or above the pain tolerance threshold of unanesthetized conscious animals. Against this backdrop of these five legitimated categories of activity, an ACC is meant to promote the reduction, the refinement, and the replacement of the use of animals. So they're supposed to promote the reduction of the numbers of animals, the refinement of technique, presumably so there's less suffering, and the replacement of animals with other means like computer modeling, for example. What I want to suggest is that these formalized and legitimated categories of action discipline humans to think and act in terms of these categories. That is, these formalized categories make humans into subjects who enact these sorts of relations with members of the community. You know, we might ask why category E even exists. Why does it even exist? Why do any of them exist, but why does category E exist? Alongside the work of the ACC at the university, care is mostly in the hands of animal care staff. And this is also something that Elizabeth knows a great deal about. The CCAC denotes no necessary standards of training for the animal care staff. It provides only toothless and frankly banal advice. It says universities should, quote, assure that its technicians have the opportunity to become as well qualified as possible. That, quote, opportunity for continuing education should be provided and all personnel should be encouraged to participate. So does this kind of advice from the CCAC make animal care a top priority amidst tight university budgets where people are fighting for resources? Now, I want to comment about this whole region, the whole issue from a slightly different angle, and I'm drawing very much on somebody else's research who's also spoken at UBC. The CCAC regime is based in peer review. It's based in peer review of proposed research. That's how things get checked, by way of peer scientists checking each other. But the capacity for reliable peer review is in fact grossly limited. Year in and out, scientific research around the globe generates reams of information. Thousands, thousands, thousands of articles appear in scientific journals. Neither individual researchers nor their peer reviewers can stay on top of all of this never-ending new amount of information. So the potential for duplication of research is enormous, and this is obviously very bad news for animals. Now, systematic review of scientific research involves the synthesis of existing studies. It involves compiling databases, for example, of existing research so that researchers, peer reviewers, then have some systematized way to actually look for similar kinds of research. So systematic review of scientific research could create databases that scholars could then draw upon and that peer reviewers could then draw upon to assess the legitimacy of proposed research. In Canada, the research councils require systematic review for clinical trials that involve humans. They do not require systematic review of studies that subject animals. So researchers and peer reviewers lack systematic means by which to determine whether proposed animal studies are even new. But even if there were, a systematic compilation of scientific studies and systematic compilation of standing knowledge claims in Canada, studies are showing enormous problems, widespread problems in how many scientists conceptualize what they're doing, problems in how they perceive methodologically, problems in how they draw inferences, and studies are There's no systematic support in Canada for the development of alternative, non-human-based research and teaching methods. An ACC must require a teacher or researcher themselves to consider alternative methods to animal use. But how well can an ACC subsequently assess the teacher's or researcher's claims about these animals? Does this ACC have time, does it have resources and endurance, frankly, to investigate each case amid disciplinary cultures that already assume the subjection of animals as normal? Now, certainly, the language of the three R's is very compelling. It's very compelling. It suggests that universities are gradually moving away from invasive subjection of animals. And certainly, ACC oversight has micro-achievements in reduction and in refinement. But science may infinitely pose new questions. It just keeps posing new questions. Forever. And scientists are also now genetically modifying life. And that leads them to invent new questions and methods. Meanwhile, projects are funded according to the internal culture of scientific merit, not social merit, not according to social significance and manifest ethical justification. And all of this leads to the actual state of affairs that we're in, which is that the use of animals at universities is growing. It is growing. I'll just let you look at those numbers. It's time that